The Bible details so much about the revival of modern Israel. What we're going to see tonight is that Israel has gone through an amazing resurrection. Just wait for some people to take a seat. Thank you again for your attendance. From being dead as a nation to being one of the most vibrant countries on planet Earth. And this has happened within a really short space of time, and very recently. You may know that Israel literally sprang onto the world stage in the last 100 years. And what you may know is, what you may not know is, that Israel had been waiting to emerge for 2,000 years. And over the next 40 minutes or so, we're going to see just how the Bible told us these major changes were going to happen thousands of years in advance. If ever there was any doubt about the Bible's authority, Israel is the living proof that God exists, that he has a plan and a purpose with the earth, and that Israel was written into the pages of the Bible as proof, the evidence that what the Bible says can be relied upon. Now, Bible critics believe that millions of Bible believers and churchgoers around the world are wasting much time, money, and energy. They believe that humanity's condition could be greatly improved if those resources were used for solving the world's problems instead of worshipping a non-existent God. Now, we don't have time to go through each point of their dispute, but that would be a whole other topic. But what we will do tonight is examine the Bible's irrefutable proof of its divine origins, which instills confidence into the reader that the messages that it contains are true, accurate, and reliable, and that the Bible offers hope for individuals and societies around the world. If there was any doubt about the Bible's authority, what it has to say about the modern state of Israel should dispel all doubt. You may ask, why Israel? How significant is this tiny nation? I know it. You know, we all know it keeps cropping up in the news, but what is all the fuss about? It's worth noting, even before we look further at what the Bible says about Israel, that over half of the Earth's population has its gaze fairly fixed upon the tiny area of Earth's surface in the red circle in the centre of our map. The land of Israel has captured the attention of three of the world's five great religions for thousands of years. And today, 2.5 billion Christians, 1.8 billion Muslims and 14.8 million Jews are very interested about what happens there, for all for similar reasons, as it turns out. And you'll see on the map that the purple colour represents the majority Christian or Christian heritage countries. The green on the map shows Islamic countries, and the other countries represent the other world faiths. And you could say that this interest in this insignificant strip of land that is hardly distinguishable upon the map is responsible for shaping domestic policies in nearly all other countries on earth, either directly or indirectly. The obvious question is why? The only answer is, this is exactly what God wants and what the Bible said would happen. If ever there was a significant ethnic identity, it is the Jewish people. In many countries, Jews are considered or viewed as a significant minority in the eyes of those countries' laws. And if ever there was a country of immensely disproportionate importance relative to its tiny geographic footprint, it is the state of Israel. But you wouldn't know it if you watched the nightly news. On the screen we read in Deuteronomy 11 that Israel is a land which the Lord thy God, it says, cares for. The eyes of the Lord are always upon it, from the beginning of the year even unto the end of the year. Ladies and gentlemen, the eyes of God are on the land of Israel. You don't see that reported in the nightly news. In God's eyes and in the pages of the Bible, the microscopic territory we know as Israel, with its minuscule population, are of monumental importance to God and of immense consequence to all people of earth. But also in the eyes of the world, Israel punches well above its weight in many aspects and is noted keenly by many nations for its many successes and innovations. Note Zechariah 2 verse 8, "He that toucheth you, Israel, touches the apple of his eye." Israel to God is a very sensitive topic. So let's quickly recap on what modern Israel is. Modern Israel is one of only two liberal democracies in the Middle East. It has a parliamentary system. It has proportional representation. It has universal suffrage. It has a prime minister and a president as head of government. It has a population of 9.2 million, which is the combined total of the states of New South Wales and Queensland, incidentally. It is a developed country. It is a member of the OECD. It is the 33rd largest economy in the world by GDP. That is $403 billion. It has the highest standard of living in the Middle East. And it is one of the top countries in the world for military training, tertiary degrees, research spending, women's safety, life expectancy, innovation, and happiness. Let's have a look at a catchy overview of the history of the Jewish people and the land we now call Israel. This clip was produced in 2018. Some of you may have seen it before. It was produced in response to then President Trump's decision to move the US embassy to Tel Aviv, from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, a move that was controversial and electrifying at the same time and caused many to ask why the US valued its relationship with Israel so highly that it would risk upsetting other countries over this decision.
Some claim that Jerusalem is an occupied city. They admit that once upon a time it was the capital city of the Jewish people. But they argue it lost the title some 2,000 years ago, after it was destroyed and its Jewish inhabitants were exiled. And they say, in 1967, the Jews showed up and took Jerusalem from the Palestinian people. So in that case, why does President Donald Trump want to move the US embassy to Jerusalem? Here is the truth about Jerusalem and the Jewish people. Jerusalem was the capital of the Jewish kingdom established by King David 3,000 years ago. His son, King Solomon, built the first temple in the place where, according to tradition, the binding of Isaac and Abraham took place 1,000 years earlier. The Babylonians destroyed the temple and exiled the Jews, but the Jews quickly returned. 500 years later, the Romans destroyed the second temple. But did that end the Jews' connection to Jerusalem? The answer is a resounding no. In the 2,000 years that followed, empires came and left, conquered, colonized, and occupied Jerusalem, never turning it into their capital. While the Jews, Jerusalem's indigenous people, continued living in and returning to Jerusalem, despite the hardship and danger involved. Over 1,000 years ago, the Arab writer Muqaddasi complained that the Jews constitute the majority of Jerusalem's population. Jews remained a majority also in modern times, as documented by the British Council in 1864. And Jerusalem was always the center of Jewish life, even for those living far away in the four corners of the earth. Special fast days and rituals mourn the destruction of the city, and daily prayers express the hope of a full return. In Islam, a religion which was established only 1400 years ago, Jerusalem was never as holy as Mecca or Medina. In fact, Jerusalem isn't even mentioned in the Quran. Compare that to the 669 times Jerusalem is mentioned in the Hebrew Bible. Even Muslims on the Temple Mount turn their backs on Jerusalem and face Mecca when they pray. Whether in America, Russia, Iraq, or Iran, the direction of prayer for Jews has always been Jerusalem, the uniting force and the heart and soul of the Jewish people. So what really happened in 1967? First of all, there was no Palestinian entity. In 1948, Jordan conquered the eastern part of Jerusalem, dividing the city and expelling the Jews, destroying their homes, synagogues, and cemeteries. Western Jerusalem was re-established as Israel's capital, while Jordan's capital remained Amman. Then, in 1967, in a war of self-defense, the Jewish state liberated and united its historic capital city. What has happened since then? Israel has returned Jerusalem into a vibrant city and a house of all nations, establishing the freedom of worship to all peoples and religions. So, why does President Trump want to move the embassy to Jerusalem? The real question is, why did it take so long?
The real issue is, President Trump was acting because God decreed it was so, and that Israel would take an increasing presence on the international stage. What we're going to establish is that God talks in advance of doing anything, and the Bible establishes this. So in Amos chapter 3, we read that before the Lord God does anything, he tells his plans to his servants, the prophets. In 2 Timothy in the New Testament, we read that all scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete and equipped for every good work. The Apostle Paul here is clearly saying that the writings of the Bible and all the prophecies and predictions that went before, including all of God's intentions, are declared up front by God himself. And of course, in Isaiah 43, speaking about Israel, God says, "You are my witnesses. I have chosen you so that you may know and believe me." Here God plainly says that Israel is the witness of God. Wait, what? You might say. The Bible says that the Jewish people are there to witness for God. And on the basis of that witness, people will know and believe who he is. This is an amazing statement. Not just because these words were written 2,500 years ago, but because they are just as relevant and true today as they were back then. The fate of Israel, ladies and gentlemen, is densely packed into the pages of the Bible. The Bible is full of hundreds of precise statements and prophecies that have been fulfilled in detail in history and are being fulfilled in our times, quite remarkably. Now, before we get back to the Bible prophecy about Israel, let's acknowledge that people throughout the course of history have been fascinated by the Jewish people. Their successes, their failures, the fact that despite being cruelly punished throughout history and spread across the face of the earth, they are still here today. They are a strong ethnic and religious identity with a vision and a purpose. Now, this captured the imagination of many historical figures. The English historian Henry Milman in the 17th century recorded this: massacred by thousands, yet springing up again from their undying stock, the Jews appear at all times and in all regions. Their perpetuity, their national immortality, is at once the most curious problem to the political inquirer, to the religious man, a subject of profound and awful admiration. The American author Mark Twain, in his writing concerning the Jews in Harper's Magazine, 1899, wrote, "All things are mortal but the Jew. All other forces pass, but he remains." What is the secret of his immortality? He writes, "If statistics are right, the Jews constitute but 1% of the human race. It suggests a nebulous, dim puff of stardust lost in the blaze of the Milky Way. Properly, the Jew ought hardly to be heard of, but he is heard of, has always been heard of. He is as prominent on the planet as any other people, and his commercial importance is extravagantly out of proportion to the smallness of his bulk. His contributions to the world's list of great names in literature, science, art, music, finance, medicine, and abstruse learning are always out of proportion to the weakness of his numbers. He has made a marvellous fight in this world in all ages, and had done it with his hands tied behind him. He could be vain of himself and be excused for it. All things are mortal but the Jew, all other forces pass, but he remains. What is the secret of his immortality?" A very good question. Probably the most influential of the historical figures to comment on the Jews is Adolf Hitler, who in his infamous work, Mein Kampf, wrote the following: "When over long periods of history I scrutinize closely the activities of the Jewish people, suddenly there rose up in me the fearful question whether inscrutable destiny, perhaps for reasons unknown to us poor mortals, did not with external and immutable resolve desire the final victory of this little nation. Was it possible that the earth had been promised as a result, a reward to this people which lives only for this earth? Hence today I believe that I am acting in accordance with the will of Almighty God." In this extract, Hitler acknowledges that the Jews' dogged persistence raised a fearful question. He refers to the Jews as a nation and reflects that the earth has indeed been promised to them. Despite this reflection, we all know what came next. Hitler went on to commit the most heinous act of genocide in history against the Jews, despite his fearful admiration of where they came from and what their purpose may be, as he tried to wipe the earth free of the Jews. However, as Hitler rightly identified, this tiny, tenacious nation has a destiny mapped out by the Almighty himself. God has a purpose with Israel. Jeremiah tells us, "I am with you and will save you, declares the Lord. Though I completely destroy all nations among which I scatter you, I will not completely destroy you." Not only would God save the Jewish people, there are multiple Bible passages talk about a restoration not only of the Jewish nation but of the Jewish monarchy. Many Old Testament prophets and New Testament apostles speak of the restored kingdom of Israel. Ezekiel 21 speaks of the prince of Egypt, Israel, who was Zedekiah. It says, "whose day is come, Thus says the Lord, remove the diadem, take off the crown. I will overturn it until he come whose right it is, and I will give it to him. A future king is promised the crown of Israel. Micah, on a similar theme, the daughter of Zion, to you shall it come, the former dominion shall come. Kingship for the daughter of Jerusalem. And Acts chapter 1. Jesus is in the company of his disciples. It says he presented himself alive to them after suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? The restoration of the nation of Israel, ladies and gentlemen, is a precursor to the return of Jesus Christ and the establishment of the kingdom of Israel with Jesus Christ as its king. It's fascinating when you think about it to consider how history works out. Let's look at the words of Jesus in Luke chapter 21. This is known as the Olivet Prophecy. The prophecy foretells what was going to happen to Israel 30 years after Jesus' death, how it would be trodden underfoot for 2,000 years, and how ultimately Israel would be transformed from a forgotten backwater into a vibrant, modern, economic miracle whose amazing resurrection is confirmed by Bible prophecy. Now, in my Bible, the heading for this section reads, the destruction of the temple and the signs of the end times. So we know that we're talking about two events. One that was immediately in the first century, around the time of this writing, the destruction of the temple, and one that was a long way off, 2,000 years in fact, fulfilled in our times, the revival of the state of Israel. What we see here in this passage, verse 20 to 24, we see a prophecy of what would happen to Jerusalem and the Jewish people in that time frame. Now, if your history is a little bit shaky, we saw it in the clip in AD 70, the year 70 AD, at about the time of Passover, the Roman Titus, General Titus, besieged Jerusalem. And since that action coincided with the Passover, the Romans allowed pilgrims to enter into the city, but the Romans refused to let them leave, thus strategically depleting the city of food and water within the walls. And within the walls, the Zealots, a militant anti-Roman party, struggled with the other Jewish factions that had emerged, which weakened the resistance even more, to the point where Josephus, a Jewish historian of the time, who had commanded rebel forces but had then defected to the Romans, attempted to negotiate a settlement. But because he was not trusted by the Romans and he was despised by the Jewish rebels, the talks fell apart. Ultimately, the Romans encircled the city with a wall to cut off supplies, and the city was completely reduced and starvation ensued. By August of AD 70, 5 months later, the Romans had breached the final defences and massacred much of the remaining population. They also destroyed the Second Temple. The Western Wall is the only existing trace of the Second Temple that remains, and to this day remains a site of prayer and pilgrimage. The loss of the Second Temple, the loss of the temple for a second time, is still mourned by Jews all around the world to this day during the fast of Tisha B'Av, which occurs in August. Now, Rome celebrated the fall of Jerusalem in the following way, by erecting this enormous triumphal arch, the Arch of Titus. And thus the great Jewish diaspora began and continued right up until the start of the, through the Age of Enlightenment, the commencement of the Industrial Revolution, the discovery of the Americas. The map shows the displacement of the Jews. You might be able to make out the black names and dates are where Jews were expelled from and when, and the red names, if you can make that out, are where they went to. The diaspora continued. And the next slide will show the extent to which Israel was substantially diminished in population and preeminence, and just how mightily it has roared back. You see, when the Romans sacked the city of Jerusalem in the year 70 AD, the decimated population was around 3 million people and reduced immensely during that siege that we described earlier. The survivors were dispersed through the far reaches of the Roman Empire. Fast forward 19 centuries to the beginning of the 20th century, there are only 40,000 Jews living in the land of Palestine, with the Jewish population of Jerusalem being only 8,000. Today, by contrast, there are over 9 million people in the land. As we said before, the population equivalent to two states of Australia, New South Wales and Queensland. The chart on the right-hand side of the screen illustrates this so well. An exponential population surge 1900 years after the city was reduced to rubble. This happened because God said it would. Just like Donald Trump moving the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. It happened because it had to happen, because it was foretold in the Bible. Let's step through some key passages that foretell the demise of the Jewish nation through to its restoration. In Isaiah, we read, Zion, that is the Jewish people, says, "The Lord has forsaken me. The Lord has forgotten me." God responds, "Can a woman forget her nursing child and have no compassion on the son of her womb? Even these may forget, but I will not forget you," says God. "Behold, I have inscribed you on the palm of my hand." Now, we all know that if there's something important we have to remember, we tell our children not to do this. And school teachers get very irritated at this as well. Writing notes on our hand is something that is frowned upon, but everybody does it for the important things of life. Where do we get this trait from? Obviously, from God, who himself has inscribed Israel, his most valued treasure, on the palm of his hand. Isaiah tells us, "Do not fear," says God, "I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you." Through all of its disbursement that went on for 19 centuries, God says, "Surely I will help you. Surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand," possibly the one that has their name inscribed on it. "Behold," that was my left hand, I meant my right hand. "Behold, all those who are angered at you will be ashamed and dishonored." All of those countries through the latter part of the Roman Empire that kept expelling them would be shamed and dishonored. "Those who contend with you will be as nothing and will perish." In a similar vein, the prophet Jeremiah, who wrote about 75 years after Isaiah, declared that God would preserve his people. He writes, "I am with you, declares the Lord, to save you, or I will destroy completely all the nations where I have scattered you. Only I will not destroy you completely, but I will chasten you justly and will by no means leave you unpunished." Jeremiah then uses an extreme example to describe God's guarantee that Israel would be restored. He writes, "Thus says the Lord," God speaking here, "who gives the sun for light by day and the fixed order of the moon and stars for light by night, who stirs up the sea so that its waves roar. The Lord of hosts is his name. If this fixed order departs from before me, if the solar system ceases to work, declares the Lord, then the offspring of Israel will also cease from being a nation before me forever. In other words, the chances are zero. Thus says the Lord, if the heavens above can be measured and the foundations of the earth searched out below, then I will also cast off all the offspring of Israel for all that they have done, declares the Lord. You know, it's an interesting fact of life that we know more about the surface of the moon than the floor of the ocean. God says, when we can work out the foundations of the earth, then I will cast off Israel. Well, we are a long way to even mapping the ocean floor, let alone what lies beneath it. So when will the Jewish people cease to exist? When the sun stops coming up and going down, when the seasons of the year cease to come and go, only after all the heavens and the depths of the oceans have been fully probed and explored. In other words, the Jews will never cease to exist. They would never, will never be forgotten by God, and his compassion would see them restored to greatness. Isaiah the prophet affirms this. He says, then it will happen on that day that the Lord will again recover the second time with his hand the remnant of his people who remain from Assyria, Egypt, Pathros, Cush, Elam, Shinar, Hamath, and from the islands of the sea. He will lift up the standard for the nations and assemble the banished ones of Israel and will gather the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. This great restoration began 2,600 years after these words were penned. In the 1890s, it was sparked by a booklet which was written by a man called Theodore Herzl. He argued at that time that the time had come for the Jewish people to return to their homeland. The booklet captured the imagination of Jews around the world, and they began to return to their homeland, but not in any serious number, which was then called Palestine. And at that time, at the turn of the 20th century, there were approximately 40,000 Jews in the land of Israel, which is approximately the population of Morisset and a few other areas around it. Not many people at all through that whole territory. But here's the amazing thing. This return and reorganization of Israel as a nation was foretold by the prophet Ezekiel in his vision of the dry bones 2,500 years before. Ladies and gentlemen, no other nation has ever been so completely dispersed from its homeland and has yet tenaciously maintained a national identity for 2,000 years. No other nation has steadfastly remembered their capital and prayed repeatedly for the restoration of that city, because no other nation has had these prophecies made concerning its history. Other nations which have been dispossessed of their land have lost their identity within decades. But what happened to Israel is nothing short of extraordinary. Foretold in the prophecy of Ezekiel 37, the vision of the valley of dry bones.
The hand of the Lord was upon me. He brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley.
It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley. He asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? I said, O sovereign Lord, you alone know. Then he said to me, Prophesy to these bones and say to them, Dry bones, hear the voice of the Lord. I will make breath into you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, Prophesy to the breath, and say to it, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into these slain that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army.
We have only seen the first stage of Ezekiel's prophecy fulfilled. Israel has returned to their land as predicted. Their dried bones have reformed. They have stood up on their feet. But it wasn't until after the declaration of the establishment of the State of Israel in 1948 that they were able to conquer the city of Jerusalem in the War of Independence that followed. And thousands of years of prophecy came to pass. Jeremiah emphasizes this amazing fulfillment in a startling statement. He says, The days are coming, declares the Lord, when it will no longer be said, As the Lord lives, who brought up the sons of Israel out of the land of Egypt, but As the Lord lives, who brought up the sons of Israel from the land of the north and from all the countries where he had banished them. For I will restore them to their own land, which I gave to their fathers. This is an incredible statement, preempting that the reestablishment of Israel would come out of the lands of the north, just as it has done. Jeremiah is saying here that there is a day the Jewish people will look back on the history of their nation and will conclude that the greatest miracle of their history was not salvation from Egypt and the exodus through the Red Sea, but the regathering from the four corners of the earth, a miracle far greater than the deliverance from Egypt. Zechariah the prophet goes further and makes it really clear that they would have a capital city and Jerusalem would once again be theirs. Words written 2,500 years ago. Old men and old women will sit in the streets of Jerusalem. The streets of the city will be filled with boys and girls playing in its streets. The Lord says, Behold, I am going to save my people from the land of the east and from the land of the west, and I will bring them back, and they will live in the midst of Jerusalem. 500 years before the time of Jesus, these words were written after the return from the Babylonian captivity, after they had resettled themselves in Jerusalem, looking forward to the time after the destruction of Jerusalem by the Romans. So this is a prophecy about a future resettlement of a city that only happened 55 years ago in 1967. Around many of the time that people my age were born, or just before that, as the next clip shows.
Μικήμα.
It is no wonder that on that day in 1967, Chief Rabbi of the Israeli Army, Rabbi Shlomo Goren, came to the Western Wall, blew a shofar, and then proclaimed, "We have taken the city of God. We are entering the Messianic era for the Jewish people." He said that because he knew that the prophecies say that when the Jews are back in their land and in their city, the Messiah and his advent are not far off. And that brings us to the modern era, doesn't it? And we have seen the desolate land become fertile, the dispersed people return, the dry bones revitalized and reassembled. In Luke 21, we read the parable of the fig tree. And through the Bible, the fig tree is a symbol of Israel's national identity. The Bible compares Israel to figs and the first of the summer figs. We read here, Jesus said to them, "Look at the fig tree and all the trees. When they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is near. Even so, when you see these things happening, you know the kingdom of God is near." And that is what we have seen through the late 19th and 20th centuries, starting in the 1800s, gaining momentum around 80 years ago. The nation of Israel was reborn. Jews from around the world pouring back into it in fulfillment of Bible prophecy. And in accordance with what the prophet Jeremiah spoke, the Jews would not be willing returnees in any significant number until the horrors of what we know from the Second World War occurred and gave reason for many to reconsider and return to the land of Israel. Jeremiah said that certain tragic events would need to happen. God would send for fishermen and for hunters to give encouragement, if you will, for those dispersed peoples to return to their homeland. That has happened. Ezekiel said, "I will take you from the nations, gather you from the lands, and bring you to your own land." And return they did. The Exodus of 1947, the cargo ship of 4,515 Holocaust survivors were determined to get to Palestine. The British Army, however, decided to turn many of these boats around and return many of them to Germany. There were many of these ships, and the nation of Israel, long dispersed, flooded back to the promised land. What was Israel? What was Palestine like when they returned? Well, in 1866, 80 years before these events took place, the author Mark Twain travelled to the land of Israel, called Palestine at the time, and recorded the following conditions on the ground. He noted in his work, Innocents Abroad, the land of Israel was an inhospitable wilderness, incapable of sustaining a modern society. He writes, "It is a blistering, naked, treeless land. Of all the lands that are for dismal scenery, I think Palestine must be the prince. It is a hopeless, dreary, heartbroken land. Palestine sits in sackcloth and ashes. It is desolate and unlovely." Then, after World War II and the horrors of the Holocaust, Israel burst onto the international stage, declaring itself a sovereign nation on May 14th, 1948, in this desolate, blistering, heartbroken land. On May 14, 1948, standing before the special assembly gathered in Tel Aviv, Prime Minister David Ben-Gurion promised, "By virtue of the natural and historic right of the Jewish people and the resolution of the General Assembly of the United Nations, we hereby proclaim the establishment of the Jewish state in Palestine to be called the State of Israel. And on the 16th of May, 1948, the Palestine Post ran the sensational headline, State of Israel is born, and recorded the moments fulfilling Bible prophecy. It reads, you may be able to follow along. State of Israel is born. The first independent Jewish state in 19 centuries was born in Tel Aviv as the British mandate over Palestine came to an end at midnight on Friday. And it was immediately subjected to the test of fire. As Medinat Yisrael, the state of Israel, was proclaimed, the battle for Jerusalem raged, and most of the city falling to the Jews. At the same time, President Truman announced that the United States would accord recognition to the new state. A few hours later, Palestine was invaded by Muslim armies from the south, east, and north, and Tel Aviv was raided from the air. On Friday, the United Nations Special Assembly adjourned after adopting a resolution to appoint a mediator, but without taking any action on the Palestinian resolution of November 29. Yesterday, the battle for Jerusalem, Tel Aviv Road, was still underway, and two Arab villages were taken. In the north, Acre town was captured, and the Jewish army consolidated its positions in western Galilee. Momentous and spine-chilling. Ladies and gentlemen, only 3 years later, by the mid-1950s, after the UN had declared the area of known as Israel to be the homeland for the Jewish people, and Israel had declared itself a sovereign nation, what was foretold by the prophet Jeremiah came to pass. Go, proclaim these words toward the north. Say, return, faithless Israel. The Lord led the seed of the house of Israel out of the north country and from the countries whither I had driven them, said the Lord, that they shall dwell in their own land. Behold, I will bring them from the north country and gather them from the furthest part of the north. He who scattered Israel will gather him. During the 1950s, incredible changes on an industrial scale would start occurring to the natural landscape. The bleak, blistered, and desolate land described by Mark Twain began to change. The barren, parched land was reclaimed. The mosquito-infested swamps were drained. The deserts converted to agricultural use. Trees planted by the million. Water conservation technology was developed and innovated and rolled out, and water channeled carefully to agricultural regions, transforming arid wastes into fertile plains. So by the end of the 20th century, Israel had become the breadbasket of the Middle East, growing every kind of crop imaginable. Ladies and gentlemen, during the 20th century, the people of Israel greened the deserts by planting over 250 million trees. Israel ended the century as the only nation in the world with more trees than at the beginning of the century. This in itself is a remarkable feat of engineering and logistics. But Israel's miraculous resurrection wasn't just agricultural. More than living securely, Israel is now the most vibrant liberal democracy on earth, with one of the most vibrant economies on the planet, a centre for global technology companies.
This one is called Startup Nation, the story of Israel's economic miracle.
Startup Nation.
Startup Nation.
Startup Nation.
Startup Nation, the story of Israel's economic miracle.
What's behind this amazing story?
This was a huge story about innovation, about changing the world that wasn't being told, that needed to be told.
Startup Nation is probably the most important book written about Israel.
The
Israel is the fastest growing, one of the most dynamic, entrepreneurial, and innovation-based economies on the planet.
Every year it produces more startup companies than China, Japan, India, and the United Kingdom.
How did Israel pull this off? In the least likely of places, surrounded by adversaries, in a state of war since its founding, no access to natural resources, completely shut out from the region because of the Arab League boycott, no access to regional capital, no access to regional markets, with a tiny domestic market of its own, how did they pull this off?
We think of innovation as mainly about ideas, but it's really not, because there are a lot of countries with a lot of great ideas with as many patents as Israel has, and yet they don't have nearly as many startups.
What's amazing about Israel is not just the startups in this little startup nation, but the fact that we have large companies of scale who are leading in these clean technologies.
So we figured out that there are two other big ingredients that go into startups, and one is a lot of drive and determination, and the other is a willingness to take risks.
When you look at the NASDAQ, companies are listed from around the world. There's one country, though, that truly stands out, and that is Israel.
It's a cauldron of creativity and creative energy, and of really dynamic, really interesting, really diverse group of people solving really big problems in the world. Problems in the world that, if they can be solved, will truly make the world a better place.
Google, eBay, Intel, Cisco, the CEOs of these companies say, at 25 years old, the average Israeli has far more leadership and entrepreneurial experience than their peers anywhere else in the world.
Israel really is a whole country of Silicon Valley.
Startup Nation is about how that creative energy went into one sector, into tech. But that same creative energy goes into social startups, amazing social startups in Israel, into the arts and culture. It makes sense that creative energy comes out in many different forms.
This book that takes Israel beyond the conflict and shows the real Israel.
What's exciting about this whole story is that whatever you're into in your community, whether it's your university, your hospital, your business, or whatever, you know that there's something going on in Israel that's very creative that would be perfect to work together, you know, to join forces. And this is kind of, I think, a new paradigm for working with Israel.
Israel's resurrection from destruction in 70 AD, through 2,000 years of dispersion and persecution, is nothing short of amazing. All because God is on their side. God said it would happen, and that's exactly what happened. What we've seen tonight is how Israel's restoration to its land was foretold. We've seen why it happened in the first place, what the nation had been through for 2,000 years, where it is today, and we've seen how the Bible told us these major changes were going to happen thousands of years in advance. Isaiah says, I'm God. There is no other. I'm God. There is no one like me. Declaring the end from the beginning. From ancient times, things which had not been done. Saying, my purpose will be established. And I will accomplish all my good pleasure. Calling a bird of prey from the east, the man of my purpose from a far country. Truly I have spoken, truly I will bring it to pass. I have planned it. Surely, I will do it. The authority of the Bible is unchallenged. Israel is the Bible's answer to all of its critics. God said Israel was his witness. Their rebirth on the mountains of Israel is proof of God's plan and purpose. And as we read in Luke, when all the trees had begun to bud and Israel as a nation is re-established, God's well-documented plan to establish a kingdom centered in Jerusalem with Jesus Christ as its king is about to happen. Thank you for your attention.